morning, everybody. Number 618 will be our first song. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, that calls me from a world of care and bids me at my Father's throne. Make all my wants and wishes known. In seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief, and oft escaped the tempter's snare by thy return, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer.
And so what he does when he discusses that is he talks about the breadth of the work. He talks about you need to be praying, you need to have supplication, you have intercessions, you need to pray every type of prayer there is, for lack of a better phrase. And then he talks about it for everybody. He talks about it for men, for women, for people who are in charge. So he talks about the universality of prayer. He talks about how not only should you pray a lot of different types of prayers, ask for different things, but you should pray for everybody. And so prayer is kind of this backbone that Paul uses here when he talks about the necessity of prayer. And Paul's saying this for a very important reason. When he talks about prayer, he's not just wasting his breath, because the work of the church is to glorify God. That's what we're doing here. We worship God, we serve God, and then we act as his beacons out in the world around us. But the backbone, as we just mentioned, for all of that should be prayer. And I like the way that Paul ends that when he talks about in 1 Timothy chapter 2, how he ends this in verse 8, because he begins in verse 1 talking about prayer, and he ends it in verse 8 talking once again about prayer, because he says, "Therefore I want the men in every place to pray, lifting up holy hands without wrath and dissension." Now before I go any further, I think the holy hands there can be used when your hands are physically on your lap. I don't think you have to raise them physically up in the air. But what he says here in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8, and I like the way he says that men need to lift their hands. He talks about men or prayer being a masculine activity. And that's not to say that women can't pray. Don't mishear me when I say that. I'm not saying that women can't pray. As a matter of fact, I would argue that on a lot of occasions, women are much better at prayer than men are. But the point is in a public sphere, men need to be the ones to pray, but especially they need to pray earnestly towards God. And men as a whole, and I think every man and possibly every wife here will agree with me, that men have a hard time sometimes praying. Because we sometimes have our time tapping into those emotions, those things that we need, and the reliance on other people. What I'm here to tell you right now, ladies and gentlemen, true men, real men, pray. And real leaders, pray. When you look throughout the scriptures, for instance, in Luke, the 6th chapter, verse 12, when you see right before Jesus selects his 12 apostles, these are the men that are going to go out into the world, that act as his ambassadors for the gospel, and will live decades sometimes into the future. The thing he does right before all of that is he goes on the mountain and he prays all night. Right before Nehemiah heads back to Jerusalem to rebuild the walls of God's city, Nehemiah chapter 1, the cupbearer, the king of Esdras, gets down on his knees and he prays towards God for the work that is going to take place. Real leaders, ladies and gentlemen, pray. But real leaders don't just pray for themselves. Real leaders don't just pray for the work that they're doing. They pray for the people that they're leading. I've asked this morning, you may have noticed that things are a little bit different this morning. I've asked our three elders, Paul, Shell, and Cody, to come up this morning at different points in time and lead us in prayer for different things. We're going to sing some songs. I'm going to have a good, my normal 45 minutes to an hour devotional a little bit later. But we're going to sing some songs. We're going to have some prayers. But I want the elders specifically to focus on the prayers and needs for this congregation. All three of them are going to pray for different things. But it's prayer on behalf of this church. For the work that they're doing.
118. When upon thy fields you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. Your blessings, name them one.
Heavenly Father, for being so patient and long-suffering with us. And thank you, Heavenly Father, for this avenue of prayer that we're able to engage in, that we can make known our needs and our desires and our cares and lay them before you. Thank you for the abundant blessings that we so often take for granted, that we think we have done ourselves, that we have created ourselves, when in fact it all comes from you. Thankful, Heavenly Father, for your Son, his willingness to lower himself to come to this earth as a man, salvation to mankind. Thankful for his willingness to die on the cross, to suffer the shame and reproach that we might have the hope of salvation. Thank you for your grace, Heavenly Father. Even when we deserve nothing but punishment, your grace is overflowing. Heavenly Father, thank you for making your will known to us in a manner that we can read and understand, even the simplest of mind. For anyone that seeks to know your will, it is possible to read that and understand and know what you would have us do. Heavenly Father, we would ask your continued blessings on us and those of our number that are not able to worship with us any longer, as you comfort them. Give us for these sins, as Christ in the name we ask. Amen.
Oh, very thankful for each and every one that is able to be with us here today. We're thankful for this day that we can come here and sing songs of praise and join in one another in study and learn more about the Bible. We would like to, at this moment, we would like to say a special prayer for the ones of our number here, Sister Bobby Gunnels and Jerry Gunnels, and Brother Bobby and Jerry Gunnels, as Bobby recovers from her hip surgery and her failing health as well. We'll pray that thou will watch over Brother Howard Joyce Curtis as Howard continues to improve in health from his recent fall. We pray that thou will watch over and be with the doctors as they administer the treatments to Sister Dorothy Curran as she is tired from the treatments. We pray that thou will watch over many of our congregation here of unanswered prayers. We pray that thou will watch over Sister Kelly Carrington as she travels back and forth with the family as she may have to undergo some more treatments. We are especially thankful for the ones of our number that have been through treatments in the past and their strength and determination as they have battled that illness and came out on the fabulous side of it. We're also thankful for the example that they have been to us here, as they have always been strong and never give up, and no matter how bad it can be at times. We would like to pray that same prayer for strength and determination in our everyday lives in a world filled with sin. We pray we will all adhere to the teaching of 1 John 2 and steer clear from the worldly things such as the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. We pray that thou will watch over us as a congregation here as we always strive to do the things of thy will. We pray that if we ever steer away from that, we will be guided back quickly. That way, in the end, we can be found worthy and we can come to a home with thee in heaven if it be thy will. We pray that thou will watch over us here. God, guard and direct us. All these things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
So. So grateful for our many blessings. We're thankful for the abundance of physical blessings that you bestow upon us. And most of all, we're so grateful for the spiritual blessings we have. We know that we live in a time and in a country that affords us so much, including the freedom to gather this morning, to assemble in this worship service, to have assembled in our Bible classes, the opportunities to study your word and all this without fear from those around us. But we sometimes become complacent. We come to you complacent, confessing that from time to time we take these blessings for granted. Even though we have so much, we sometimes are disappointed that we don't have more. And sometimes we're even guilty of using our blessings in an inappropriate way, even to the point of sin. For these shortcomings, we ask your forgiveness. We ask for forgiveness, and we also give thanks that we have a mediator on high. We thank you for Jesus and all he means to us. We're grateful for the life that he led as an example for us. We're thankful and will always be thankful for his willingness to die on the cross. That as the supreme sacrifice for mankind, we can have the forgiveness of our sins. And we are comforted and thankful in knowing that since we have the forgiveness of our sins, we alone share the hope of heaven. Help us to live our daily lives in such a manner that when our earthly lives are over and our physical blessings are no more, we can receive that blessing which is like no other. And that's a home in heaven for eternity. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
We just finished in our Sunday morning class discussing the Old Testament, specifically Samuel, Kings, and Chronicles. One of the people that we discussed in that class, although we obviously didn't do it justice because we kind of breezed through him, this person, Hezekiah. Hezekiah has always kind of stood out to me as one of those very interesting figures that you see in Scripture that is almost undervalued just because he kind of goes and then he becomes and he goes and we don't really spend the time on him. But when you look at the life of Hezekiah, what you see is just an unbelievable amount of faith that this man has. You see it, for instance, in Isaiah chapter 37, which 37 through 40 of Isaiah's work, kind of where Hezekiah's story comes from. But you look at Isaiah chapter 37, when Sennacherib's army is right on his doorstep. And Isaiah, instead of calling for help from other nations, instead of rallying the troops, what he does is he goes out and he bows his knees towards God in front of everybody. And he asks for God's protection and prayer on his nation. And then you flip the script to chapter 38, and that's the story that everyone knows when we think about Hezekiah. Because Isaiah 38 is where Hezekiah has fallen sick. And now Hezekiah prays towards God, and God answers him with 15 more years of life. But if you notice that prayer, and if you're in Isaiah chapter 38, look at specifically at verse 3. Because what verse 3 says, or what you notice when you look at verse 3, is you notice that Hezekiah never once asked God to heal him. In Isaiah chapter 38, verse 3, what he said was he asked for God to remember him. Remember how I have walked before you in faithfulness and with a whole heart, and have done what is good in your sight. That's the prayer that Hezekiah, at least that's recorded for us in Isaiah chapter 38. And God then responds for a few verses later by giving him another 15 years of life. And that's a fantastic story. It's great. We love it. Hezekiah gets to live a little while longer. But to a lot of people that read the story of Hezekiah, that story almost seems unfair. Because when you read the story of Hezekiah and how he doesn't even pray for help, he doesn't even ask for it, and God, for some reason, gives him 15 more years of life, we look at that prayer and we look at our own situation and we demand of God, where is my 15 years of life? Where is my answered prayer? Where is my hope? And there are people that are sitting in this auditorium right now that have sat next to the bedsides of people who are dying, who have struggled with people or struggled with something personal or have done something in their life that they prayed to God earnestly for 4 years. And they look to God with this Hezekiah mindset and they ask him, where's my 15 years? Where is my answered prayer? Where is God when I need him? And we ask the question, we demand of God almost like Job does. We ask the question, does prayer really even work in the first place? Now, it would be very easy for me to get up here, especially since nobody's allowed to talk back to me at this portion of the service, it'd be very easy for me to get up here and simply say, prayer works, here's the reason, here's the evidence, and then we move on with our life. But I don't think that's fair. I don't think that's fair to the people that are in this auditorium that are struggling with this question. The people that have sat in hospital rooms and have held the hands of people, their loved ones, and they've watched as cancer has ravaged their body. To those people, this is a real question. To people who struggle with severe anxiety, to people who struggle with depression, and who have prayed to God for decades asking for His help, and nothing seems to come through. They ask God repeatedly. This is a real question for them. This means something to them. For the person who struggles with same-sex attraction, and who has prayed to God earnestly that God would help him to find a healthy biblical relationship, a healthy biblical relationship, that he knows that's scripturally approved. This is a real question. And as we answer this question, as we look at this question, we then look at passages such as Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 through 6, which almost seems like a tease at this point. Because in there, Solomon says in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 through 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. And in all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make straight your paths. It's hard for somebody who is struggling with that question to read that verse and have faith. Then you go two verses more, Proverbs chapter 3, verses 7 through 8. And at that point, it almost just seems cruel, because God says, be not wise in your own eyes, fear the Lord, turn away from evil, it will be healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones. A lot of God-fearing Christians look at that passage, and look at those verses, and they ask God, I have lived for you. I have lived for you for years, for decades, I've served you. Where then, and we ask as the older brother does in the parable of the prodigal son, where is my fatted calf? Where is my redemption? Where is my answer prayer? And I'll be honest with you, I don't have the answers to those questions. And I've sat with more people than I care to count, more people that you probably care to count. You've all sat in these situations where we just don't have the answers to those questions. But for those people, I would say this instead. Instead of saying and demanding of God, where is my 15 years of life? I would encourage you to take a step back and ask yourself some questions. Starting with, first and foremost, what are my expectations? What are my expectations when it comes to prayer? Do we expect a situation like Hezekiah, where we pray towards God with a very simple prayer, we ask Him to remember us, and then we pop right up out of bed, and all of a sudden we have 15 more years of life? Because it certainly seems that way when you look at Scripture. When you look at Scripture, you have Jesus healing people, people that are blind, people that are bleeding, people that are paralyzed, people that are dead. And Jesus heals them. And you can look at the Old Testament, see Elisha and Elijah healing people. You can see Naaman getting healed of his leprosy. All sorts of miracle stories in Scripture. And we ask God, where is my 15 years of life? That's what I want. But for every one of those stories, which you also have in Scripture, it's a story like 2 Corinthians, where Paul cries out to God three times, asking for the thorn in the flesh to be removed from him. Do you remember what God says? 2 Corinthians, God says to him, my grace is sufficient for you. Power is perfected in weakness. What God told Paul, and it's something that people who struggle with these things, they know intimately, is that in those times of trial that we learn our greatest dependence on God. I don't know anybody here. If you're here, we need to have a serious psych evaluation. But I don't know anyone here that would wish to go through cancer. I don't know anyone here that would wish to go through a period of intense struggle in their life. But I'm telling you right now, there's nobody here that has gone through that would trade that road for anything. Because they've come out of it on the other end a much stronger person. And God knows that. God has the advantage of omniscience. God has the advantage of knowing everything and seeing the whole picture. Genesis chapter 18, you know this story. Genesis chapter 18, where Abraham and Lot are two different places. Lot is close to Sodom and Gomorrah. Abraham has pitched his tents elsewhere. And the angels come to Abraham in Genesis chapter 18 and tell him that Sodom and Gomorrah are going to be completely annihilated. In Genesis chapter 18 and verse 23, Abraham comes near and says, will you indeed sweep away the righteous with the wicked? Suppose, God, that there are 50 righteous within the city. Will you indeed sweep it away and not spare the place for the sake of the 50 righteous who are in it? Far be it from you to do such a thing, to slay the righteous with the wicked, so that the righteous and the wicked are treated alike. Far be it from you. Shall not the judge of all the earth deal justly? What gets lost in the text sometimes is the intensity that you can feel behind Abraham's words. And then he says there in verse 26, the Lord said, if I find in Sodom 50 righteous people within the city, then I will spare the whole place on their account. Sodom and Gomorrah, by the way, probably numbering between 5,000 and 10,000 at this point. All I need is 50 people. Abraham replies in verse 27, "Now behold, I venture to speak to the Lord, even though I am but dust and ashes. Suppose the 50 righteous are lacking 5, and you destroy the whole city because of 5. And he said, "I will not destroy it if I find 45 there." He spoke to him yet again and said, "Suppose 40 are found there." He said, "I will not do it on the count of 40. He said, "Oh, may the Lord not be angry, and I shall speak. Suppose 30 are found there." He said, "I will not do it if I find 30. He said, notice this chain continually going, "Now behold, I have ventured to speak to the Lord. Suppose 20 are found there." He said, "I will not destroy it on account of the 20. Then he said, "Oh, may the Lord not be angry, and I shall speak only this once. Suppose 10 are found there." And he said, "I will not destroy on account of the 10. And as soon as he had finished speaking to Abraham, the Lord departed. You have this interesting back and forth happening between Abraham and God, where Abraham has a dialogue with God, which doesn't happen a ton when you're talking about God the Father. And what Abraham asks him is, suppose 50, suppose 45, suppose 40, 30, 20, 10. Suppose I can find some people. Will you avert your judgment? And God says, "Yes, I will." That speaks, ladies and gentlemen, to the power of prayer. That Abraham beseeched God on behalf of Sodom and Gomorrah. But what the story also illustrates is that Abraham didn't have the full scope of it. When Abraham is trying to save Sodom and Gomorrah, and he says, "You'll sweep away the righteous with the wicked," what he's assuming is that there are a lot of righteous people alongside Sodom and Gomorrah, alongside the wicked in Sodom and Gomorrah. And what Abraham doesn't realize is that God has searched out the people. And in a town of 5,000 to 10,000 people, you can't find 10 that are even heard. And so even though God wishes or God answers Abraham's prayer, what Abraham realizes is that he's not the full picture. Sometimes when we pray towards God and we demand things, we demand an answer. We ask like Job did. We demand an audience with the Almighty. We sometimes expect God to do something that, quite frankly, he never promised he would do. Matter of fact, the one command you have repeated most often throughout Scripture is not, "I will make all your dreams come true." It's not a Disney fairy godmother. The one response that he has is, "Serve me and I will bear you up. I will raise you up with wings like eagles. And though this world may be tough, in the end, be a good cheer, for I've overcome the world." Ask yourself a second question too. Do I believe that there's some kind of formula? Sometimes people treat God like a vending machine, where we put a prayer quarter in and then we expect that we would get an answer, maybe along with some change that comes alongside it. But we expect that we can just pray towards God. And if God hasn't answered my prayer, then it's because I wasn't on the right knee. I was on the left knee. Or we sometimes think, well, it's because I didn't have the Bible up, I didn't have my left hand on it, I wasn't of the right mindset, I didn't say the right words, and so we treat God like he's some kind of vending machine. And if you remember in 1 Kings chapter 18, when Elijah is staring at the prophets of Baal are very vividly trying to manipulate their God to answer him. They cut themselves, they dance, they do all sorts of sacrifices. They're trying to get something to prod their God to act. Elijah doesn't do that. Elijah simply offers a prayer, offers a sacrifice on the altar, and then prays towards God, and God responds. And then you look at Naaman, 2 Kings chapter 6. And Naaman says, "Well, instead of washing the Jordan 7 times, what I really thought God would do is come over here and wave his arm, and then all of a sudden I'd be miraculously healed. I figured that would kind of be the formula that we would have." And when we say that, what we're essentially saying is that we expect God to work for us. We expect God to do my bidding. That if I can just have the right prayer technique, then maybe God will listen to me. But that's never been the case. That's never been the answer. Can you imagine a world where all we had to do was get the right technique and every prayer would be answered? All you had to do was pray, say your prayer on the left knee, and you had to say so many Hail Marys, and all of a sudden God would answer every single prayer that you had. Can you imagine a world where that happened? Thanks be to God, ladies and gentlemen, that he doesn't answer every single prayer that man throws up towards God. My fear is sometimes we get so caught up in saying prayers towards God, making sure we have the right formula, making sure we have the right words. We get so caught up in saying prayers towards God that we forget that what we're essentially doing is talking to him. We get so caught up praying to him that we don't talk to him. And we think that we can manipulate him somehow as if there's some kind of formula to get what we want. Question 3. Am I relying on my emotions for my answer? Here's what I hear sometimes from people. People say, "Well, I prayed and I prayed and I prayed and I prayed, and I've heard it hundreds of times in my very limited time as a preacher, my very limited time as a Christian. I've heard numerous people say, I prayed and I prayed and I prayed and I prayed, and it just hasn't happened yet. And my question, my answer back to them, my question in the form of an answer, is how do you know? How do you know it hasn't been answered? Somebody who's praying, and patience is the obvious one. I pray for patience, and they give me a son-in-law. That's what my father-in-law says. But you pray for perseverance, and then you're presented with some completely ridiculous struggle. Or you pray for love, and then you're given, I don't know, maybe a new Labrador or something. You pray for something, and you're given this burden. So the question is, why did God just give me what I asked? And we ask, and we demand of God somehow, there we believe that he's just going to kind of supernaturally imbibe us with whatever it is that we ask. But what if the very process of prayer, what if the very process of trial and growth, a process that in some places can take years, but that is the answer to your prayer? As any person who's engaged in construction will tell you, if you build a house in a week, outside of one of those home renovation shows, if you build a house in a week, that thing ain't going to stand when a hurricane or a tornado or even a West Texas wind blows through. The best houses are built over time. They're built on solid foundations that take time to settle. They're built with strong, reinforced framing. They're built with love and with attention to detail that only comes over time. Those are the houses that survive storms. So let us there, Mary, process of your perseverance and your trial that is the answer to your prayer. In the 4th century A.D., there was a woman named Monica who was a devout Christian, and her husband was not a devout Christian. Monica's husband was borderline abusive, he cheated on her, ran around all over the place, and so Monica constantly was praying towards God that her husband would be saved, and he eventually did. Monica's husband became a Christian. That was a very famous for his time Roman politician. But Monica's son, on the other hand, was a complete reprobate. Monica's son was running all over the place, was committing gross immoralities. But what Monica's son was mostly engaged in was engaged in every type of philosophy and hedonism and worldview that you can engage in. And Monica's son was the one that she was really after. And so when Monica's son went all over the known world at that point, chasing these religions, chasing these philosophies, she, unbeknownst to him, followed him. And she watched him, and she kept earnestly in prayer for her son. And her son eventually turned to Christianity. His name was Augustine. And he became one of the most famous Roman theologians, the most famous theologians in the first 1,000 years of church history. And many years later, looking back on his life and the persistence of his mom, he said, if God seems so slow in responding, it is because he is preparing a better gift. He will not deny us. God withholds what you are not yet ready for. He wants you to have a lively desire for his greatest gifts, all of which is to say, pray always and do not lose heart. Perseverance is one of the most vital commodities that we have in our prayer life. The ability to have faith and constantly go to God and pray. That's what we need in our life. We're going to sing for our invitation song, a song that's very ironically titled, On Bended Knee I Come. And it's ironic because when we sing the song, we're all going to stand. We're all going to sing it towards God. But on bended knee is the right approach towards God. Maybe not physically, but emotionally, mentally, spiritually, on bended knee, we need to come towards God. And so this moment is for you. If you need to come to God in repentance or obedience, we're ready and we're here to help. But I ask you to come on bended knee. Won't you come?
On bended knee I come. With a humble heart I come, bowing down before your holy throne, lifting holy hands to you, as I bend my love anew. I
read in your word that we have your love. We do not understand why. We cannot comprehend its depth. Father, we are eternally grateful that we do have such a wonderful blessing. All because of your grace. All because of the sacrifice your Son, the Christ, Jesus of Nazareth, made on our behalf. We thank you so much for everything that he has done for us and continues to do for us, teaching us how to live on this world, interceding for us in heaven, and one day coming back to claim us. We can't understand why you do all of this for us, who are so unlovable, who are weak, who are sinful. And yet you love us, and for that, Father, we thank you. We pray that you would look at these offerings of prayer that we have offered today in such a meager way, and that you would look on it and you would be pleased with what you have heard, that it would go up to you as an aroma, as a sweet incense before you. We pray that you would look at the songs that we have sung and that you would, again, be pleased with what you have heard, that you see those whose willingness to obey you, whose willingness to submit to you, is ever at the forefront of our minds. So, Father, we pray that you would look at our fears, that you would look at our dreams, that you would look at the requests and the supplications and our petitions this morning, that you would incline your ear to them. And, Father, if it would be in accordance with your omniscient wisdom, that you would grant those requests, that you would grant those petitions, and that you would ease those fears, that you would ease the sufferings that we have weighing on us and those of our number. Father, we pray that you would continue to teach us to pray. Because we are little children, we do not know how to go in, how to go up. We pray that you would continue to teach us so that whenever our Savior returns, that you will find faith on the earth. So at this moment, if just for today,